It's what I should have done years ago, you waster!
Oh! No!
Follow this light. It will help you concentrate. Remember every word I say.
Once upon a time, you could go to the pictures and not really know what you were going to see until the lights went down. That was the age of the B-movie, and it was a great age.
You need one for the message, two for the blow, three for the Benzedrine, and then you go and go.
B-movies were cheap, and they were short, and they were usually British. And between the 1930s and the 1970s, they offered support to the main feature. And I love B-movies because I love argon, and because, well, in these days of breathless hype, the idea of modest, inexpensive pleasure has all but vanished. The B-movie couldn't afford illusion. It had to show you what Britain was really like, because it was too cheap to hide it.
Take a look around you. I've worked my fingers to the bone so that you can have all the comforts. A gas fire in every room, electric light.
And sometimes it wasn't a very pretty picture. B-movie Britain is a shabby, seedy sort of place. It's the fatherland of frustrated desire and low humour. And maybe that's reason enough to love these films. So, welcome to the cheap seats. The cheap seats were the ones at the front and the sides, where you had to stretch your neck to see properly. They were the perfect place from which to watch cheap British B-movies. British B-movies are more or less ignored. Some of them are rich encapsulations of all our yesterdays. Some of them are rubbish. But in this programme, we'll give credit where it's due and confront the guilty with their past misdeeds. So how do you feel when you watch it now?
Ashamed.
You'll also get to see clips from plenty of films that are smart, full-blooded, thrilling or daft, and hear stories about some of the men and women who made them. Lots of these pictures are very hard to get to see, and yet they're just as much part of our cinematic heritage as films that are never off the telly. They were called B-films because they were often bad. They were made on a budget. The ones we're looking at were British.
226-1195, hello? Hello!
And for decades, they played at the bottom of the bill.
I don't want dancing, I want pitching!
This is absolutely...
So in this presentation, the second features are the main attraction. So let's start with a form of cinema whose lowly status is in no doubt. A kind of film that's a byword for slackness and ineptitude, but which could also produce moments of breathtaking surrealism. Welcome to the Quota Quickie. The quota quickie films of the 1930s are notorious. They've been accused of bringing British cinema into disrepute, for giving work to people who didn't know where to point the camera.
We've known each other for quite a time now.
10 days, to be exact.
Yes. Well, what I wanted to ask you was,
Frank, are you proposing to me?
Yes. I hope it hasn't come as too much of a shock to you.
Shock? Good heavens. I've been expecting it for at least a week.
Were those cats part of a clever piece of associative montage, or is it just a screw-up? In the quickies, it was usually a screw-up.
Record for me, darling.
And this is the last record you're going to make.
Do a bit of reading on the subject of the quota quickies of the 1930s, and you'll soon come across the story of the vacuum cleaners. This is how it goes. The quickies were so slackly made and so transcendentally boring that they were projected to empty cinemas while the charladies were still hoovering up and down the aisles. That's the story anyway, and like a lot of stories about the British film business, it's not particularly true.
80 years ago, the British film business had its back against the wall. American companies controlled the cinema chains, and it wasn't in their interest to be nice to the competition, so they connived to keep homegrown productions off their screens. Stanley Baldwin's conservative government decided to do something about this. It was all very patriotic. They passed an Act of Parliament that guaranteed a place for British films on British screens.
Well, the idea of the Act was economic and cultural. Economically, it was supposed to stimulate the British industry, create more employment, etc. Culturally, it was supposed to represent Britain on screen. There was concern at the time that Britain was missing out to America, not just in economic terms, but in terms of promoting the British way of life.
I was telling Miss Jean how you used to queen it.
Queen it?
When all the gentry was here.
Oh, that. You make it sound so dreadful, Bonnet. You know, I think I will have something hot if cook won't think I'm queening it.
The quickies were speedy in every respect. They rarely ran for over an hour, and they were made as nippily and as cheaply as possible. And that was partly the fault of the legislation. American distributors and exhibitors needed to buy these British films to avoid a fine. £1 a foot was the price tag. So to make a profit, producers had to make them for less than that, cutting every possible corner.
The quickies were made usually in 2 to 3 weeks. That's 5 days a week, and not many went over that. Some were made in a week. You couldn't pay a lot for the script, couldn't pay an awful lot for actors and stars, so they tended to use West End theatre actors.
Shot in the Dark is one dodgy quickie that employed a gaggle of West End stars, and this is the magnificently distracted O.B. Clarence as a crime-fighting vicar. The other man is Russell Thorndike, brother of the legendary stage actress Sybil Thorndike. Presumably, he was a much cheaper booking than his sister.
Would you like to see her standing in the dock on a charge of murder? Sit down. Alaric gave him his ordinary medicine every night.
Yes?
There was no poison in that.
No.
Well, she gave him his medicine on the last night as usual.
Yes.
There was poison in that.
How did she know?
Never mind. But she knows that you know.
What the hell are you driving at?
Shot in the Dark was directed by George Pearson, a veteran from the silent days, who made this after coming back from Hollywood. It must have been hell out there, because he seems to have lost the ability to direct movies. I'm not really sure what's going on here. Is this actor supposed to be dead? Okay, yes, he's dead. Oh, he's alive again. No, I don't know. What do you think?
Michael.
To speed up filming and save money, Pearson adopts a technique you'll see in many quickies. He doesn't rely on editing. Instead, he keeps the camera static and moves the actors around inside the frame. Let's take a closer look at how Pearson choreographs his team. Michael Shepley's centre stage, but in comes Dave Burnaby with an intervention from the right. O.B. Clarence shimmies forward. Burnaby steps slightly to his right to allow Margaret Yard to steam on through, and everybody mills. Many quickies made their money by padding scenes out with bits of business. Very useful if you're only being paid £1 a foot. Have a look at this scene. It takes this chap 43 seconds to make these cocktails. It's not very interesting to watch, but this martini has just made the producers over 60 quid. Cheers. So the legislation had nothing to say about quality control, which meant anyone could join in.
I beg your pardon, my lord. I heard a noise in the servants' quarters. I thought something might be wrong.
Well, I didn't make any noises.
There was a gold rush to make quickies, and Twickenham Studios was its Klondike Valley. They were founded in 1929 by the dynamic Julius Hagen, who took over a former roller skating rink and turned it into Britain's first 24-hour film factory. and that meant that things could get pretty stinky. In his autobiography, John Mills recalled arriving for work one morning and getting a lungful of a delicate blend of cigarette butts, orange peel, stale beer, makeup, and several unmentionable gases.
I'm all right.
Twickenham only had one soundstage, but Hagen scheduling made it the second most productive film studio in the country. In every department, he exploited the economy of scale. He signed up a crack squad of dependable performers, romantic leads and character players, men like Sir Seymour Hicks, who Hagen recruited to recreate their acclaimed stage acts for the screen.
Yes, well, of course, that was only a coincidence. Oh, Lord, look what I've done. Coincidence, darling. You see, things do happen like that, in a way. And if you... would you kindly take one, my love? Oh, I beg your pardon. What a muddle I'm getting into. Darling, would you like a little butter, my love, dear?
Charles, you're very jumpy. You sure you're not feeling anxious about anything?
No, darling, of course I'm not. Of course I'm not. Darling, have a banana, darling.
I hate bananas.
I see. Yes.
You know, I would...
Hicks deserves to be better known, as does another of Hagen's regulars, the fabulously plummy Michael Shepley.
Hooray! The party is waking up at last.
If you take only one thing from this documentary, let it be this. Michael Shepley rocks.
Nasty little girls very often go to prison. Especially when they're thieves as well as nasty. Nice little girls very often get presents.
As well as his fine and fruity acting, he's also great at being electrocuted. Twickenham helped to nurture other actors who would go on to become household names. People like Merle Oberon, Alistair Sim, Jack Hawkins, Margaret Rutherford, one of our greatest character actors, and John Mills, here out on the lash, in The Lash.
I've come to the conclusion that I'd like to take a little pub. A little pub. I'm sure I'd make a success of it, because I'd be such a darn good customer myself.
With stars like that clocking on at the studios, it's no wonder that some of the quickies aren't clever and surprising. Unlike most of their critics, I've sat through dozens of the things, and yeah, some of them are dull enough to put a wasp to sleep. But there are some first-class, second-class films.
Let's take a ride with this one. The Last Journey was directed by Bernard Vorhaus. Mad Vorhaus, they called him, because he did everything at such a lick. And this is a good subject for him. The Last Journey is about madness induced by velocity. It's speed minus Keanu Reeves on board the 8:32 to Manchester.
Stand away!
The film follows a winning formula. It gathers together a cast of familiar faces to play a gang of juicy stock characters. The plausible bigamist, the credulous victim, the self-made industrialist, the Harley Street doctor, and then threatens to smash them to pieces at 100 miles an hour.
Keep her going. Keep her going. It's the last trip.
Here's the man who wants to smear them over Piccadilly, Julian Mitchell, the old stoker who's been driven out of his mind by half a century of chuffing. And have a look at how Vorhaus conveys the speed at which the train is travelling. Some smart work with wind machines and back projection. But most of all, lots of real trains, courtesy of the Great Western Railway. No dodgy model shots, just crowds of extras risking their feet and noses by standing on the wrong side of the yellow line. Good as it is, The Last Journey didn't make Hagen any money. It cost £27,000 and grossed just under £26,000. When the film was released, Twickenham was already in trouble, partly because Hagen liked to write out lots of noughts on his own paycheck, partly because of his habit of schmoozing hacks at lavish champagne parties. So when the studio went bust in 1937, what did he do? He threw a lavish lunch at the Mayfair Hotel, and everyone got smashed. In the 1930s, cinema going was part of everyone's weekly routine. Lots of moviegoers loved the extra bit of value the quickies added, and many were hits in their own right. Michael Powell's Lazy Bones was booked into more cinemas than many A-movies. And Badger's Green was also a smash at the box office. The quickies knew exactly who they were for.
they would go for the maximum appeal to the maximum number of viewers. They would usually have to take account of the female viewer, because women in the 1930s were the majority of the audience, so probably 60% of the audience.
Here's one for that 60%, and the title is 100% ironic. This isn't a film about romance. It's a film about self-sacrifice and emotional pragmatism. It's a film for a constituency of grown-ups that engages with one of the trickier social issues of the time, having children out of wedlock.
I don't kid myself, I'm the sort of mother a girl's going to be proud of. What do you mean? Who are you? What are you? Why should I hate you?
The best quickies like this tackle tough subjects in tough times. Many others are triumphs of cheek over poverty, and that must have been part of their appeal in the 1930s. In those lean years of the Depression, that's exactly the kind of triumph we needed. But by the end of the 1930s, there were forces at work in the world that would hurl the quota quickie into the dustbin of history. Forces personified by one man, a man whose face was everywhere in the decade that followed the first cinematographic films Act, a man with a neat little moustache and madness in his eyes. No, not him. That's more like it. War killed the quota quickie. It nearly killed British cinema too. Picture houses closed down, ice creams languished inside locked freezers, Pinewood Studios was turned into a store for bags of flour.
I see you stand like greyhounds in the slips, training upon the start. The game's afoot. Follow your spirit, and upon this charge, cry God for Harry! England and St. George!
But the shutdown didn't last long. Despite the bombing, war made Britons hungrier for a night at the pictures than they'd ever been before. The Prime Minister was persuaded that big budget epics like this and going to the movies would be as good for home front morale as raising the chocolate ration.
Churchill thought it was very important. He commissioned the coloured version of Henry V, and that was done for patriotic reasons. Cry God for Harry, England and St. George. It was the victory of England on the continent, and that was very important to him. But those films during the war were important because, apart from anything else, they helped to keep the spirits up.
As well as expensive epics, there were cheaper ways for the government to get its messages across.
This is a bomber factory in Britain. The workers have arranged with their management and their joint production committee to build a bomber in the record time of 30 hours.
These are the British B pictures with the strongest critical reputation, the productions of the Crown Film Unit.
The clock strikes 9 and the record-breaking attempt begins. Two sections of the fuselage are carried in. The dark girl with the riveter there is Eileen Daphne, who used to work in a rayon factory.
Pictures like this, Workers' Weekend, are perfectly crafted documentaries in a British version of the Soviet style. But then there were a lot of talented people on their books. People like Laurie Lee, E.M. Forster, Benjamin Britten and Sir John Mortimer, years before he took the silk and wrote all those Rumpole books.
What do you remember about the day-to-day work in the Crown Film Unit during the war?
Absolute chaos. Certain amount of sex going on, and also I lost people, and they used to stray off.
Who did you lose?
I lost a lot of electricians. That was my worst thing, on the way to Liverpool. And we were going to make a film about a bomber aeroplane being made in 24 hours. So we didn't find them again until the aeroplane had been finished.
I don't know if you noticed her, but Ivy Bennett caught my eye. I noticed her because she was wearing a very sheer pink chiffon blouse. I remarked on it, but Ivy grinned and said she'd come away from a party in a hurry so that she could get on this night shift and help to make this record-breaking bomber.
Who were the most colourful characters in the unit?
Then we had one brilliant director who was Humphrey Jennings. He made rather beautiful and poetic films.
Listen to Britain is one of Jennings' best. It has no commentary, just evocative images and music from wartime Britain. Done very simply, this short film expressed something very deep about how people felt about living through the war and what they were hoping for when it was all over. The work of the Crown Film Unit looms large in the most influential histories of wartime British cinema, but that's partly because the most influential histories of wartime British cinema were written by members of the Crown Film Unit. The war's big pictures also received support from much more lowbrow sources. For my money, the films that really won the war were cheap little comedies starring a crack squad of irregular performers. Big-boned comediennes in frocks and headscarves. Big-boned comedians in frocks and headscarves. A drunken, dirty old man from Bolton. And they were all from the same professional world. V stood for victory, but it also stood for variety. So when it came to licking Hitler, stage turns were as important as the raffy. This is Norman Evans, one of the men in dresses who were cheap cinema's equivalent of the bouncing bomb.
Funny thing I was only saying last week. Ooh. Nay, nay. Ooh, third time on the same brick. What did you come dashing out like that for?
Does his act seem familiar? That's because once Evans had taken his final curtain, Les Dawson kept his routines and mannerisms alive, preserving them as perfectly as this reel of film.
No, I'll have to go now. Yes, baby, sack in the middle at rice pudding. I'll see you later.
Leslie Fuller did his bit for Britain in a dress too, here with everyone's favourite clergyman, O.B. Clarence.
You know, I've enjoyed your sermons for years.
Really? I'm awfully glad.
Of course, I quite understand why you didn't speak to me at first. I know how careful you gentlemen have to be about speaking to strange girls.
Strange girl? Oh, well, quite.
Yes.
And what are you doing in the great city?
Oh, just shopping, you know. Squandering a few coupons, fiddling under the counter. Are you up on a do? I mean a jaunt.
Oh, no, no. Far from it. I'm here on a clergy convention.
Oh, you know, you clergy. You do get up to some funny things, don't you?
And here's another cross-dresser who helped to keep the British end up.
Oh, I say, Jack, this is on fire.
Yeah, it's all right. It's meant to be.
I suppose this is what you let the torpedoes up with. I've been struck with a fork of sheet lightning.
Oh, Mummy.
The scrubber on the left is Old Mother Riley, known to the Inland Revenue as Arthur Lucan. The other one is Kitty McShane, Mother Riley's daughter and Lucan's wife. Their relationship was as weird as it looks, but they were box office smashes in the war.
It was marvellous. It was when you had to see. And we were played by a man, of course, and his daughter Kitty. And they were a music hall turn. And I actually saw them on the stage at the Grand Theatre in Southport. And they were the films developed from a music hall turn. And they were very popular.
The Motion Picture Herald declared them the number two draw at the British box office. And why? In a time when behaviour was more prescribed than ever before, when messages about being like dad and keeping mum and careless talk costing lives were plastered on every bus stop and bombsite hoarding, Old Mother Riley was the shrieky voice of uproar and anarchy.
You could swallow me, could you?
Yes, I could.
Well, if you did, you'd have more brains in your stomach than you ever had in your head.
I think that the great forgotten stars of wartime comedy were two actual women, two sisters. Their films may have been modest, but there's something about these two, their naturalness, their air of capability, that still seems very fresh. You feel as if they gave voice to the real-life humour of the air raid shelter and the fish queue. Their names were Elsie and Doris Waters, Gert and Daisy.
Here, I don't like the look of it. Well, I didn't buy it for his looks.
Here we are, pushing. You want to push anywhere, push off. Look out. Oh, my, the butler's behind. Turn it round. She's seen the shit.
I think so. What should you do, ignore her? Ignore her? No fear. Don't take no notice of her. Unless she starts something.
I know, dear. And all the price has gone up. Oh. The price has gone up.
They came from a showbiz family. Their brother was Jack Warner, who later spent 30 years playing Dixon of Dock Green. They were already popular radio performers, so they came to the big screen as ready-made stars. What I like about them is that their humour was actually about the war, rather than providing a distraction from it.
What should we sing?
Yeah, I know.
We'll sing them a song about when the war's over.
Yeah. Come on, girls and boys, whoopsies make a noise. Let it go and all join in the chorus.
Forget your cares and pain, there's a turning in the lane.
And won't it be a godsend when it turns out nice again? We'll shout and bloom in rain.
Roy Hudd has been a lifelong fan of variety on stage and on screen. We settled into the cheap seats together to watch some of the fine work of Gert and Daisy.
By the time we're seeing them here in the 40s, then they're presumably part of everybody's sort of entertainment lives.
Very much on radio, you know, and I mean, they became so famous during the war. There were two aeroplanes named after them, Gert and Daisy, and my favourite was there were two elephants named after them at the London Zoo, Gert and Daisy.
But what's so lovely about this is it seems to be speaking directly to a very specific wartime audience.
That's exactly right. I think a lot of these films, they were to make everybody, particularly women, feel better and feel useful. But all their husbands were away at war, and they were still having fun, and they were still doing things, and they were obviously working for the good of the country and everything else, you know.
Put a penny underneath the pillow. If it rains, well, let it rain. In the morning you will see, when you have your cup of tea, that the sun's come out again. For fate is kind, it will make your dreams come true. Soon you'll find that the one you love loves you. Put a penny underneath the pillow at the closing of the day. Tuck the blankets round your chair, let the penny do the rest, and your luck will come to stay.
But they were good, they looked great. I always remember the film that they made with children being evacuated, you know? And we thought it was wonderful, this film. But I remember seeing that particular film when we were all evacuated to Northampton, where I was, and they put it on in the village hall. And we went to see it, and we felt so marvellous that being evacuated could be fun.
Right, so it was screened to evacuees
as
a sort
absolutely,
of... Because there's some terribly moving scenes in that film. There's one where a little girl is given to them to look after.
That's right,
it's really
quite upsetting
to watch that.
You're going in the country and see all the bunny rabbits playing in the fields.
I don't want to see any bunny rabbits. I want to stay with Mummy.
Oh, there'll be lots of nice ladies who'll play with you.
I want to stay with you, Mummy.
Oh, good afternoon, Mrs. Higginbottom. And how are you, Mrs. Brown? I'm very well, thank you. Can I come to tea with you tomorrow? Of course you can, you silly old sausage. But you'll have to bring your own sugar. Oh, dear, I thought as much.
We thought it was terrific. Yeah. And because the evacuees looked as though they were having such fun, we weren't particularly. But we thought, oh, it can be all right then. And, of course, we loved it.
Tastes like watercress.
Oh, blimey.
Doesn't smell like
it. So while the snotty-nosed evacuees of Britain snuggled in the warm, reassuring expanses of Elsie and Doris Waters, this man supplied a more vicious kind of wartime comedy. He's called Frank Randall, and his films were beaten only by Hollywood blockbusters like Mrs. Miniver, in Macclesfield anyway, down south, they didn't out. But it hardly mattered. In the north of England, Frank Randall was a kind of savage god, a lord of misrule, an idol of the people in the cheap seats.
Sergeant, go and see that those others come up for their pay correctly.
Very good, sir.
Quite right, sir. It's a disgrace. A moonlight sonata.
Give me that.
Oh, I'm awfully sorry, sir. I was hot and bothered. My pay, sir.
No, your hand.
Oh, I see.
No, you idiot. Your hand for your pay.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Now, what do you think I am, a fortune teller?
I don't know, sir.
No, your other hand.
Stupid.
Your left hand.
Ah. What's this?
Wherever there was a working class audience, Frank was worshipped because he was a real working class. He was like all the great comedians. He reflected exactly the people who were watching him out front. And that's why it was so big up north, because it's broad Lancashire, this stuff, you know.
It's very rude.
It's
too,
very
isn't
rude,
it?
Yeah.
Smutty.
One of the theories is that people were so sort of tight-arsed in those days, really, that they're always on their best behaviour. And Frank did and said things that they would only say in private.
Here's a little present for you, from me, just to mark the occasion.
Oh, thanks, sir. I'll wet the baby's heads. I'd like to give you something in return, sir.
Oh, and what would you like to give me?
The twins, sir.
That's enough.
But working with Randall was bloody hell. He hated women smoking. He hated the chief constable of Blackpool, but that was mutual. He hated theatre managers who complained when he shot out the dressing room mirrors with one of his Luger pistols. He hated it when his mistresses left him, so much that he tried to mow one down in his car.
George Melly used to sing with a band, and his band leader, Mick Mulligan, always used to chat to stage doorkeepers. And they're one of these theatres, and he said to the stage doorkeeper, "Did you ever know Frank Randall?" He said, "Did I know Frank Randall? The bugger," he said. "He was here 1 week," he said, "and he put an advert in the paper, and it said, 'Wanted, chauffeur stroke bricklayer. Apply F. Randall, the Hippodrome Theatre.'" And he came in that night and I said, "What's this advert for, Mr. Randall? Chauffeur stroke." He said, "Well," he said, "during the week," he said, "the chauffeur drives the car, but he wants a day off. And when he has a day off, I drive the car. And when I drive the car, I get so pissed," he said, "always drive into our front wall." So he has to repeat chauffeur stroke bricklayer.
"Well, go back and tell Sergeant Corris that you'll be better in a dog's home."
"Dog's home? I used to work in one."
"Whatever doing?"
"Bring a lamp posting for the dogs."
Come on.
Randall's weirdness and cruelty had been harnessed as a weapon of war, a peculiarly British weapon of war. The Nazis would never have tolerated this sort of thing. Once VE Day had come and gone, he got weirder and crueler and couldn't be trusted to turn up for a day's filming. He staggered out of cinema in 1953 and out of life soon after, by which time his kind of comedy and variety had been banished from the screen.
Peace broke out. Labour had their landslide. In Clement Attlee's Britain, expensive cinema became more dignified. But the B-movie became drab, intoxicatingly drab. At the top of the bill, stars were busy refighting the war's best bits in colour, or larking about in glossy comedies about life among the professional classes. But at the bottom of the bill, such illusions were unaffordable. Down in the support features, characters were doing what the rest of Britain was doing, coping with a sort of social shell shock, trying to articulate the desires that victory had inspired, but without the means to realise them.
You can read all this in the dreary topography of the immediate post-war British B-movie. The nondescript streets, the suburban garages, the almost painfully bland locations. This is the real post-war Britain, the Britain my parents grew up in. And looking at these locations now gives me a kind of melancholy pleasure.
I think they present an alternative version of British society, whereas in, say, mainstream 50s British cinema, you get either the harking back to the war, or you get the colour comedies, things like Doctor in the House and Genevieve. In the B-movies of the time, you get a much more kind of downbeat, restrictive depiction of Britain, and I suppose much more of a sense of what Britain looked like at the time.
And because of that, these B-movies are a rich document of Britain during the Marshall Plan years, a time when the country was bankrupt and trying to spend its way out of poverty. Let's have a look at a couple of films from this period. Marilyn, a sex drama set in a garage in the Home Counties, and surely our only film centred around a compromised sewage pipe, the unique Private Information.
Look at Britain in 1952. Looks nice, doesn't it? That's Jill Esmond, the first Mrs. Laurence Olivier. She's playing a widow called Charlotte. Seems quite posh, doesn't she? And yet, she and her daughter live in a council house on a new estate somewhere in the Thames Valley. Underneath this pristine brickwork, though, is something very nasty. A pestilent reservoir of cloacal sludge. The council members know it's there, but they've taken backhanders to keep quiet. So it's left to Charlotte to expose their corruption in the film's set-piece speech.
You haven't been near those houses for months, otherwise you couldn't talk the way you do. They're falling to bits. The foundations are sinking. And the drains are a disgrace, too. They're made of faulty materials, and the subterranean pipe joins are insecure. And why? Because of bad workmanship, bad material, bad supervision. Somebody closed his eyes to something somewhere. And that suggests one thing to me. Bribery, graft, whatever you like to call it. But we are the people that have to suffer. Perhaps now something will be done about it.
And she starts this fantastic campaign to bring down the council and say, you're all corrupt and, you know, this is outrageous. For everybody who's tried to get through to a council and has been unable to get through on the telephone, this is the film. This is the film for you.
The film culminates in an outbreak of typhoid that has come about because of negligence on the part of the council and builders who've allowed this sort of disaster with the drainage to go ahead without being rectified. And this one woman stands against it and crusades. I mean, she's almost like a sort of 50s Erin Brockovich in tweed.
When this film was being shot, Clement Attlee was still in power. The National Health Service was in its infancy. The new buildings of the Festival of Britain were glittering on the banks of the Thames. And yet, it suggests that the hopes of post-war Britain were already poisoned, that the war had robbed Britain of its sense of right and wrong.
Listen to me, all of you. You and I are the ratepayers of this town. It was our money that paid for the Coverhill estate, and a fine scheme it was, too. But what have we got for it? Not houses that we can be proud of and our children after us, but eggshells you can poke your fingers through. In a couple of years, there'll be slums.
Now, and if old men in suits were committing crimes in the boardrooms, then their children and grandchildren, the generation that had grown up in the Blitz, also seemed to have no innocence to lose.
Britain seemed fixated on one idea, that America was where it was all happening. The land of big fridges and big steaks. The land of blonde women in tight white sweaters. In the frayed and frousty world of the British B picture, characters burned with desires for such things. Desires that would never be satisfied.
This is Sandra Dawn, and those are her pumps. Sandra was the poor producer's Diana Dawes. Here she is playing a young woman called Marilyn. Marilyn just got married. Trouble is, she married the Punch and Judy man from Heidi High, the legendary Leslie Dwyer. He runs a garage and he doesn't understand why his bride isn't weepy with gratitude for all these British mod cons of the period.
Take a look around you. I've worked my fingers to the bone so that you can have all the comforts. A gas fire in every room, electric light, and a maid to fetch and carry for you.
This is a British Postman Always Rings Twice, but one in which Dawn's desires are as transatlantic as they are sexual.
Broadway cocktail. Very smart. Of course, we should really have glasses with stems on them and little sticks with cherries on for it to be right. And a shaker, a silver shiny shaker.
Dawn uses her charms to realise her ambitions. She wants to turn Leslie Dwyer's garage on some B road in the home counties into an upmarket American-style cocktail bar. She wants to transfigure a shabby stretch of post-war Britain into a glittering fragment of Manhattan. Weirdly, she succeeds. Everyone comes to Marilyn's.
All right, very.
Only it lacks a certain glamour, doesn't it? Our dreams, even when they come true, don't amount to much in our B-movies.
I think there's a definite sense of aspiration, which from this distance makes them all more melancholy because of the wonderful shortfall. The thing in between is what makes these films pleasurable. And then the aspiration of the lifestyle, the kind of martini lifestyle and the frocks. It all seems to me absolutely the kind of place just post-war where people were projecting themselves.
You like that, Tom?
This aspiration to be like the Americans wasn't just Sandra Dawn's problem. Film producers in this country looked across the Atlantic with the same mixture of desire and envy. And one of the things they saw was a spectacular new genre that was wowing the kids all across the states. The flying saucer picture, science fiction with robots and death rays and spaceships and Martians.
I'm sure I saw a flash of light in the sky.
Really?
By the 1950s, the traditional bottom-of-the-bill B-movie was already disappearing.
The cinema was still very popular in the 1950s, but then television was coming in, and the cinema responded to that by trying to make more exciting films and expanding the screen so that you could get a different experience.
So the term B-movie began to be applied to any inexpensive genre film.
Yeah, when we come to science fiction, it shows you the difficulties in actually categorising a film as an A or B film. So a film like Devil Girl from Mars, which we tend to think of as a classic B-movie, at the time played either as a main feature or as a co-feature with a similar sort of film.
And why do we think of a film like Devil Girl as a classic B-movie? It's the over-the-top soundtrack and the way-out design. What lovely roundels that spaceship has. In British science fiction, aliens often come to our place. It's cheaper that way.
You fools.
So here, most of the action takes place in and around a bar in the Highlands, where the locals try not to be too impressed.
Mrs. Jameson, may I introduce your latest guest, Miss Naya. She comes from Mars.
Oh, well, that'll mean another day.
Naya has come to Earth to harvest Scotsman to alleviate the sperm drought back home. It's over half a century since Patricia Laffan performed diabolical acts like this.
Oh, that's a good close-up. That's very good. Very nice. I don't know who this guy was.
No.
Or no, I can't remember.
But you, you can't remember his name and you killed him.
I know.
There's only his glasses left.
Patricia had worn a toga in Quo Vadis before slipping into something far more uncomfortable here.
I must say, Patricia, you look amazing in this film. You look like some kind of expressionist drawing. It's almost the, you know, the makeup and the costume is quite something.
Well, I remember going to the fitting and saying, you forget that even on Mars they do have a coffee break. They do want to go to the little girl's room, and I can't. And when we had the first day shooting, of course, there was a coffee break and all that bit, and it took about an hour to get me back. So from then on, no coffee, little tea break and hardly anything. It's a very uncomfortable film from that angle.
So you all sort of trussed up inside it then?
Well, completely, you see, and very hot too, being PVC. It was terribly hot and shiny, and there you are. But very sexy. I don't know why people still think it's a very sort of sexy costume. I suppose it is.
I think it was worth suffering for, wasn't it?
Well, I suppose so, yeah.
This is what you call perpetual motion.
Perpetual motion? Impossible.
You talk like a primitive savage. Because your science has not discovered these things does not mean they're impossible. Even inventions as radio and television you would have considered impossible 100 years ago.
Did you get a lot of good publicity from it?
Well, in the time, I do know that my telephone number had to be changed because people kept ringing up, let the devil go for Mars. I said, no, it isn't. Bang, I want to get some sleep, you know. And then I used to come back. Well, so there was a man waiting when I was blocked of flats. I lived in studio flats in Notting Hill. And there was a man waiting to get the devil girl. And so we had... had protection, you know.
Oh, so you
special.
Had you had stalkers then as the devil girl.
Even then, absolutely stalkers then.
Pat's not come to Earth alone. This is her robot, Charney, and together they make a formidable team. The film was produced by the Danziger brothers, two cheerful men with a reputation for being cheap and quick. Actors on bigger pictures used to joke, hey, there's 5 minutes of coffee break left. Let's make a film for the Danzigers. But you know, sometimes you could have done a lot worse.
I suppose it's got its magic because it's so strange.
There's certainly nothing really else like it that was made in.
Mind you, Star Wars is better, I think. actually.
When you hear the expression B-movie, it's this kind of picture, the sort with monsters and robots, that comes to mind. In the 1950s, the idea of the B-movie was shifting from being a trade description to a cultural value judgment about cinematic theme and genre. For the next two decades, the bottom of Britain's cinema bills was plagued by small-scale incursions from outer space. And that's just fine, because our native science fiction has always been at its best when it's turned the ordinary world into a circus of horrors, when it's made you feel unsafe on your own street. The Earth has been devastated, and the few survivors do battle with an army of killer robots. There's no fleet of flying saucers here, just two aliens strolling around a village outside Guildford.
We're out here. I'll show you.
The covert invasion is something I think the British films do extremely well. The best of these films do have a sort of slightly dreary, austerity Britain quality to them, which really works.
So in the British sci-fi B-movie, the identity of the alien was more likely to be revealed by the way it handled a packet of fags than a ray gun. Here, an alien has taken over this chap's body, but why would the alien know how to smoke? Well, would you be able to light up if you really looked like this? The Trollenberg Terror wasn't the weirdest thing to land in Britain in the 1950s. After the war, Attlee's government had struck back at American invaders by taxing foreign film imports at 75%. All that produced was an American boycott. Then, in 1957, came a new piece of legislation that tried to keep both sides happy, the aliens and the natives, and its name was the Edie Levy.
The Edie Levy was introduced by Harold Wilson, actually, and he was very proud of it. But it was a means of recycling money from the actual cinemas themselves into the production side.
The Edie Levy was raised on sales of cinema seats, and that a percentage of that money fed back into a production fund, which British filmmakers could draw on. Or, in fact, Americans making films in Britain could draw on it too, and that became quite an important incentive for the Americans to make films in Britain.
So, Edie money was too juicy a prize for alien film producers to resist, and it caused an invasion.
One unlauded maverick genius was at the vanguard of this invasion. His name was Herman Cohen. He liked a fast book, but he liked gorillas better. And his career demonstrates what happened when Americans came here to make films that they couldn't afford to make in the States.
Cohen once worked as an usher in Detroit, but after the war, he followed his heart's desire to make cheap films about monster gorillas. Then he made his fortune from a picture about a werewolf. But the lore of the simian world kept drawing him back. So he came to Britain, where he made a gorilla film that promised to put King Kong in the shade. I know what you're thinking, that's a chimpanzee, not a gorilla. But watch this. That's Michael Goff as Dr. Decker.
I shall prove conclusively that I can inject the essence of plant cells into the animal bloodstream. Ultimately, I shall be able to change the shape of human beings.
Stop it, Charles, you're mad!
Dr. Decker seems as passionate about our furry friends as Herman Cohen.
Please leave. I want to be alone with Conga. Conga, listen to me very carefully. That's right, look at me.
After all, we know each other much better than the world suspects.
The film is as bonkers as The Doctor. It has carnivorous plants.
Look, Margaret, how they devour these chunks of meat.
It has a remarkable performance from Claire Gordon, future star of films such as Commuter Husbands and Sex Farm.
I'd like to volunteer. I want to help, especially with those new discoveries that you hinted at in class. When you spoke of them, there was a look on your face, Doctor, that thrilled me. It made science very interesting.
It is very exciting.
And it has pop sensation Jess Conrad, until this happens anyway. And the finale is probably the most exciting sequence ever shot on Croydon High Street. Herman secured permission to film here by sending a colour television set round to the house of a senior policeman. Unfortunately, he forgot to ask permission to fire all these guns and bazookas. Dozens of residents complained, but the police supplied Herman with the names and addresses of the complainants, and Herman went round with flowers and chocolates and killed the rebellion, as dead as Conga, whose final resting place will be just outside of Easton's on the High Street. But Herman's interest in low brow ridges didn't perish here. 10 years later, he persuaded Joan Crawford to be in one of his last movies, Trog, in which Crawford teaches the missing link how to play football. Trog has been discovered by a gang of earnest young men who've decided to go potholing in nylon boxers. I don't know much about caving, but that seems like a bad idea. Trog's a killer, but Joan has decided to mother him. She was famously hideous to her own offspring. Remember that story about the coat hangers in Mommy Dearest? Maybe this is a weird sort of expiation. Crawford arrived for the shoot with 4 cases of vodka. Perhaps that's why she had to read most of her lines from cards. But look at her. She keeps going with dignity, almost as if this film wasn't going to disappear into double bill oblivion.
Trog is not a carnivore. Fish and lizards will supply the proteins he needs until we can safely expand the range of his feeding. Trog? Here, Trog.
Herman Cohen once issued a press statement boasting that his films had never encouraged juvenile delinquency. And it seems that Trog shared Herman's unease about teenage culture. See how he responds to something light and orchestral. But then, on comes a tune for the kids, and look how Trog reacts. I suppose Trog had been down in his cave too long to know that since the mid-1950s, British culture had been transformed by the arrival of a new kind of audience. They were young, they had money to spend, and they were full of desire and ambition. You're a teenager. The year is 1954. So who's the guy who's going to fire all your cylinders? Of course, Marlon Brando, scorching the cinders in The Wild One. This is the film that defined the teenage rebellion. It was hard and it was cool. So how would British B-movies respond to and represent the rise of the teenager? Who would offer a British version of Brando's surly countercultural glamour?
Come on, Jerry, it's time to go off home.
Oh, well, I can't come just yet.
Oh, why not?
Well, I've got a date. An appointment.
This is not a conversation between two middle-aged men. The bloke on the left is Jimmy Hanley, and he's playing a juvenile. Isn't he tweedy? The other man is our old friend Leslie Dwyer. The Black Rider was made around the same time as The Wild One. Here, Hanley, like Brando, is crazy for motorbikes, but his elders are not happy.
I won't let you ride that horrible thing.
You'll kill yourself.
Oh, steady, ma'am. Remember, I was a dispatch rider on the Normandy beaches.
I never minded you riding on the beaches. The sand's nice and soft.
There's a wonderful, sweaty desperation about the effort to somehow catch a moment. Probably already about 3 years too late. But the idea that these kids and their motorcycle craze, obviously very dangerous, and the mums are all worried, but the kid, Jimmy Hanley, is, I don't know, how old was he, 48? And he has the most extraordinary figure. There are several moments of him in sort of near silhouette, and he kind of goes like that, and his ass goes out about half a yard. It's extraordinary.
The Black Rider has a plot straight from the pages of Hotspur magazine. Evil and very possibly foreign conspirators are using motorbikes and one of those old Cornish stories about phantoms as a cover to smuggle the parts of an atomic bomb ashore, bit by bit. But never mind a nuclear apocalypse, the locals are more worried about those bikes. They're gradually won over, though, perhaps thanks to cinema's only two-wheeled motorised egg and spoon race. A film like The Black Rider is caught between two audiences. It wants to appeal to kids whose desires circulate around young love and axle grease and cheeking their elders, but it doesn't want to alienate their parents too much either.
Since I've been elected president of the Swanhaven Motorcycling Club, I must have some means of transport. The only trouble is, I don't know how to start the darn thing.
So the parents learn to cope with the motorbikes of the post-war generation, while the young people are allowed to work with the Coast Guard and assist in foiling the dastardly plot. And in this very British way, youth had arrived in the British B-movie.
From mid-50s onwards, the youth audience is becoming more important. You know, B-movies also have to cater to that. So you get things like Rock You Sinners, which is 1957, a very early example of a British rock and roll musical, put together with stunning ineptitude.
Have you got the 1, 2, 3?
What's the 1, 2, 3?
You need 1 for the message, 2 for the blow, 3 for the Benzedrine, and then you go, man, go! You gotta jump to the rhythm, roll to the beat, rock on a crazy pair of vacant feet. Things I couldn't mention, fracture all your bones, heart contention. It isn't just a row, you've gotta get the message now.
Painful, isn't it? But Rock You Sinners is a landmark. It's the first British rock and roll movie. It shows us the dance halls where British rock was born, and it captures those early acts for posterity. In some ways, it's a better insight into 1950s Britain than a newsreel.
To start the ball rolling, let's give a big hand to Art Baxter and his Rockin' Sinners.
Rock You Sinners was made quickly, efficiently, and economically. It's a great example of how the B-movie could tap into changes and trends in society with a speed that the A-movie just couldn't match.
The man behind Rock You Sinners had a genius for this kind of thing. He was the most notorious producer of British B-movies ever to break an employment law or fiddle the accounts. And his name was Edwin J. Fancy, the Cecil B. DeMille of cheap British rubbish.
EJ was a clever man. He knew a lot about the Gee Gees. He knew a lot about cigars. He knew a lot about how to thrive in the cutthroat world of B-movie production. But most of all, he knew about how to get something for nothing, or very little anyway. Let's look at just one of his movies to see how he did it. The title sequence for this picture was shot from the window of his office in Leicester Square. And this, I think, is the inside of his office, pretending to be a WPC smoking room. Less than a minute later, it's redressed as the office of the Chief of Scotland Yard. And look here how he reduces the costs of this nightclub scene with stock footage of a band and some dancers. Shameless, isn't it? And here, he cleverly suggests that this car is in France by getting the cast to drive on the right, which must have been madly dangerous, as everybody else is still driving on the left. But his principal method was this. He booked the youngest, keenest talents at the lowest possible price. I wonder how much he paid the young Jackie Collins to show her legs in this fantastically glamorous bathroom. She can't have asked for a rise because he used her again in Rock You Sinners. And the other one in the tight frock is Adrienne Fancy, the producer's daughter.
He was crazy about the film industry and he was a lot of fun.
Must be lovely to have men on a string like that.
Haven't you any men on a string, Audrey?
No, most of the ones I know ought to be on a lead.
Also, he wasn't a lot of fun if you upset him, but I mean, he was a person that if you met him, it was somebody that had a very nice personality.
What sort of thing would upset him?
Oh, arguing with him or not doing what he told you to do or any of those sort of things.
EJ cast Adrienne again and again and again. And she is gorgeous, isn't she? But EJ was also a master talent spotter. He was the first person to realise that these men might be worth sticking in front of a camera. Together, they were known as the Goons. Down the mountain head, and they will lie. They were cheap back then, and they weren't the only keen, ambitious young men who got their first break from Mr. Fancy. EJ was the first man to trust Michael Winner to direct a feature film. Shoot to Kill starred Dermot Walsh, and it's been lost to posterity. But EJ's production process was textbook B-movie chicanery.
And he said to me, now this is what we're going to do, boy. He said, we're going to Switzerland, and you're going to direct this film for the Swiss Tourist Office, but we're going to stay on in the hotels. We're going to stay on, and we're going to make a second feature thriller. And he said, here is the script. And he gave me one piece of paper. I said, well, it's a bit short, EJ. Could you tell me what it is? Well, he says, it's about this man. He goes into a church. This woman is there. He goes into a restaurant. This same woman is there. He goes into an Arab tent. I have some Arab tent material. And the same woman's there. I was fascinated. I said, who is she, EJ? He said, I don't know, boy. I'll have to work it out.
Winner did just that. EJ had chosen his young protégé well. When the production relocated to London, Winner rose splendidly to the challenge of making it all look nice and Swiss.
Now, we didn't have in those days an art department like you have today, where you could transform any place into any other place. All we had to make London Switzerland was 3,000 cardboard car registration plates and a lot of sellotape. And we would go somewhere like Regent's Park, and we'd sellotape these registration plates on all the cars, deluding ourselves it looked like Switzerland. And of course what happened is people came and drove the cars away. So London was full of people driving the Swiss registration plates made of cardboard. And the funny thing, when the film came out, I won't say it was brilliantly reviewed, but in the trade press they said it was very good for the views of Switzerland. They were nearly all London and East Grinstead.
Winner also witnessed Fancy's approach to personnel management.
We were in a railway station. And one of the technicians, carpenter or something, was refusing to work overtime. He was going to leave at 6 o'clock. I said, EJ, I can't finish by 6 o'clock. We need at least another hour. So he said, don't worry. He said, I'll talk. So I said, well, I've talked to him, EJ. He's resolute, this man. So EJ goes behind the corner of the railway station, and he comes back. It's all fixed, boy. He says, he's staying till any time you want him. I said, really? He said, what did you do? You give him money? He said, no. I said, you see this fist? If you don't stay in your bleeding job, he'll be right in your face.
Here, set amid the beauty of the English countryside, is the story of the men and women who like to play it cool.
Despite Fancy's predilection for a smack in the gob, Michael Winner stayed with him to make this very successful nudie film, shot mainly in St Albans. Like Shoot to Kill, it's been lost, or that's what Michael says. Bruiser, chancer, showman, entrepreneur, whatever else EJ Fancy was, he never lost his flair for spotting talent.
Some years after I'd left him, and EJ Fancy suddenly rings me. He says, Michael! I've got five people with me. They're the ugliest people you've ever seen, he said. They're so ugly, we'll have to make an haunted house picture with them. All you could do with them is have them haunt a house. I said, but EJ, he said, I want to send them over right now to your office. I said, EJ, I've got a lunch appointment. No, you've got to... So into my office comes the Rolling Stones. All five of them.
One.
Standing on the corner waiting to go home when I
The Stones and Winner never made their film, but other Poverty Road producers, spurred on by Fancy's example, appealed to teens by filming the work of their favourite bands, or people who looked a bit like their favourite bands. It didn't matter whether the premise was bonkers, as long as there were shades and saxophones. In this one, Kenneth Connor from the Carry On films is an alien who's come to Earth to negotiate a peace between two warring musical power blocks. Beatland and Ballad Isle, home to young Charlie from Casualty and his floral love swing. Teenagers were suckered with cheap films like this, but it was a good deal. They handed over a few shillings and got Lulu in living colour.
Friends all say that one fine day I'll be the only one.
We saw how the quota quickies helped many of our greatest performers to the big screen. After the war, the B-movie gave big breaks to the next generation of stars-to-be, many of them in roles that a few years later they probably wouldn't have been offered.
Miss Stark is expecting me, I think. Mr. Spendoza.
Oh, yes, dressing room number 3, just down the way.
Thank you.
The most extraordinary sight you'll see in B-movies is the first appearance of the villain. He is wearing awful spectacles at the bottom of two wine bottles. He's got this revolting kind of black kind of toupee and this kind of buttoned-up Macintosh. You realise from the credits that he is Harry H. Corbett. Later has become, you know, young Steptoe.
Harry H. Corbett's suave serial killer drags up as a strip club stage door Johnny to carry out his cunning plan to murder all the cover stars of a jazz rag called Wow. Cover girl killer is Peeping Tom before Peeping Tom. And Harry H. Corbett's performance is an excitingly fruity mixture of perviness and moralism, just like the film.
You see, I'm not really what you'd call a professional model.
Aren't you being rather hypocritical?
I don't understand.
You hesitate to take your clothes off in front of me, yet you're quite happy to exhibit your nakedness before the whole world on the front of this filthy magazine.
Supposing he hadn't come?
In the movie, Corbett seems to know that there's a sexual revolution coming and that he will miss out on it.
Why do you have to do these terrible things?
Why? I suppose it's because I am what Inspector Brunner says I am.
He says you're a highly intelligent man.
He also says I'm insane. If wanting to give man back his dignity, to free him from the prison of lustful images which foul his mind and his sanity, is madness. Well, I suppose he's right.
Without the Edie levy, movies like Covergirl Killer would never have been made, and opportunities for new talent would have been far rarer. And as time went on, this was just the kind of film that received the biggest benefit from Edie money.
If your receipts from a cinema were £100, you got another £20 or £30 from the Edie Fund. And the support films got more. So you could say they were being supported by this fund. So it was an encouragement for British producers to produce more movies.
But B-movie producers knew they couldn't rely on this subsidy forever. The world was changing, and changing quickly. Cinema was tempting fewer and fewer people away from the comforts of their own homes and the televisions inside them.
Lots of the staples of B-movie production, the comedies and the thrillers and the police investigations, become key genres in television. So if you want to see that kind of drama, provided you've got a television, you don't need to leave your house anymore, so why would you bother?
Companies like Butchers bothered. They churned out dozens of low-budget crime B-movies like this, which were not that different from stuff you could watch at home.
Ready,
you've missed the boat.
So this is what you'd see, mid-price TV actors like William Franklin and Nanette Newman talking in front of large expanses of wallpaper.
When's the wedding?
Oh, we haven't fixed a date yet, but it won't be long. You know, Ted's just bought a little shop in the Edgware Road.
You're selling TV sets?
Mm-hmm. And repairing them, and musical instruments and radios, too.
Wow.
You'd also be taken to evocative and frousty-sounding locations on the edges of London.
Perhaps you'd better tell me how to get to the cottage.
It's on the road to Redhill, about a mile from Purley.
It's a good solid hour of crime drama, and Butch has realised that films like this could easily be re-edited and sold to television, and they weren't the only company to make the same calculation. Merton Park Studios recruited the criminologist Edgar Lustgarten for a series of shorts about Scotland Yard. They supported the Carry On films and were then sold to ITV and to the American networks.
They were inspired to be three-reel shorts for the cinema with television market overseas well in mind.
But making pictures for two markets was unsustainable. Crime B-movies were becoming cheaper, just as the budgets for TV dramas were going up. By the mid-1960s, the Butcher's type of support feature was fighting for its survival.
So in order to prolong their lives for one last desperate gasp, British B-movies had to offer something that television couldn't. And it had to be cheap. Sex is cheap. Well, some of it is anyway, and violence too. So the British B-movie entered the age of exploitation, and that was the real beginning of its end.
This is Night After Night After Night. It's about a sex killer on the loose in Soho, and it's a butcher's movie. But there's no place here for anyone as nice as Nanette Newman. This is a brutal, sleazy film about a creepy transvestite judge and his goggle-eyed, porn-obsessed assistant, whose views on women accord with those of our old friend, the cover girl killer, Mr. Spendoza.
They must have everything they want. A pill on national health, orange juice, contraceptives, everything for nothing. And when the precautions don't work, the results have to be kept by the taxpayer.
Right.
I blame the women. Walking about the streets half naked. They ask for it.
Like many of its competitors, Butchers had turned to exploitation.
The term exploitation had been used in the film trade since the 1920s. So the exploitation film was a film which was significant not necessarily for its content, but for how easily you could sell it to a paying audience.
Butcher's most famous rivals in exploitation were Hammer, who won the Queen's Award for Industry for the economic miracle they worked with sex, violence and sadism. Hammer specialised in horror films with a lavishness that belied their budgets, and they often exhibited them in double bills.
They devised a clever system in the mid-60s, and they shot Dracula, Prince of Darkness on the same sets as Rasputin the Mad Monk, and Plague of the Zombies on the same sets as The Reptile, and then swapped them.
What can I do for you?
I mean, a very efficient way of doing it, and if as long as you didn't actually watch them all together, you possibly wouldn't have noticed.
So many great Hammer movies screened at the bottom of the bill, and sometimes the B-movie at the bottom was better than the movie at the top.
I mean, Plague of the Zombies is one of the very best of the Hammer. John Carson, this wicked squire, decides to solve his labour shortage by reanimating the dead, as opposed to perhaps paying them 2 shillings in the pound or something. It's very elaborate.
Zombie.
It's beautiful. It's a wonderful thing. It has the first proper rising from the grave, pre-Romero kind of nightmare. It's really horrible. Seeing the zombies are terrific.
But as time went on, audiences got rather blasé about horror, and Hammer and their competitors had to try harder and harder to hook their audiences in. So they tried lesbian vampires. And they tried Victorian girls who transformed into giant killer moths. To stave off the inevitable, the B-movie had to go a lot weirder. And that's what's happening here. You're looking at the only teenage zombie biker frog voodoo hippie musical that Beryl Reed ever made. George Sanders is in it too, and the magnificent Nicky Henson.
Good evening. I had a telephone call from the police.
The word, Mother, is fuzz. Everybody dies, don't they? But some come back. Isn't that so?
You tried to get into the locked room today, didn't you?
How do the dead come back, Mother?
The plot is simple. Beryl Reed has made a pact with the devil. We don't get to see the small print, but there's clearly a clause about a baby. Baby grows up into a long-haired leather boy who, one night, takes his dead father's NHS glasses and finds himself attacked by the sinister power of the household frog. Got it so far?
Was there a sense, do you think, in which they thought, right, let's stick all of these elements from all of these different genres in because it's a way of attracting an audience?
It was a way of attracting money. So I said to the producers, how did you get, one day at the lunch break, I said, how did you get the money to make a piece of crap like this? He says, I just walked into the money men and said, I've got a script here, teenage motorcycle gang commit suicide and come back from the dead and terrorise the neighbourhood. I said, how much do you need? And he got it made. Mind you, it only cost about £4,000 or something.
Nick is the head of a motorcycle gang of the sort that wouldn't be seen dead in an egg and spoon race. And here's how he achieves immortality. In no time, Nicky's been interred in cinema's strangest burial scene, complete with sub-Donovan folk tunes.
He really got it on. He rode that sweet machine just like a bomb.
He felt... Once he's back from the dead, all the gang members commit suicide in a variety of eye-catching ways. All this imaginative self-murder is worth it, though, because they can come back to life and do stuff like this.
We drove through a wall. It was a polystyrene wall with bricks painted on it. But they kept it as a piece of weather cover. Just half weather cover, in case we couldn't get into the studio, but it was raining too much, as some of the stuff out in the graveyard, stuff like that. So it stayed there for 4 weeks, and it kept on fading, so they keep on painting it over and painting the bricks again. And poor old Cliff Diggins, my stunt double, he got to do this stunt again, and he drove through the wall, and the bike went straight through the wall, and he stayed outside, because there was an inch of paint on it, and it he was off to the hospital again!
But the element that really makes this a rich document of the mindset of 1973 is its anti-establishment vibe. The revolution begins, and the fine fare on Shepperton High Street is its Odessa steps. Shocking, isn't it? 5.5p for vim.
Get off!
The critics hated this. The man from the Times said it was bereft of wit and imagination, and that it was only suited for a post-prandial entertainment at an SS reunion. I've never knowingly had dinner with a Nazi, but I really like this film. I think it's moved by the true spirit of exploitation. I can't persuade Nicky, though.
What did you think it was when you were making it?
A piece of shit. But I thought nobody would ever see it. And here I am talking to you 40 years later. It's ridiculous.
So how do you feel when you watch it now?
Ashamed.
Actually, Nicky has nothing to be ashamed of. The British B-movie of the 70s could go much lower, like here, a film with a title sequence formed by shining a green light on some crumpled tinfoil. As you watch this film, you can see the life hemorrhaging from the B-movie form.
Mind if I snuggle up close? I always like something to hold on to. I say, you are a big girl, aren't you?
God.
But even with a film as ropey as this, you still get fascinating glimpses of Britain. So here's the glamour of the Manchester cabaret club scene in 1972. And here are some important figures from it who are firmly in touch with popular taste.
Fellow went to Morecambe for his holidays
and he won a lavatory brush.
Lavatory brush.
On the bingo stall. Oh. And his friend saw him a week later, and he says, how are you getting on with that? He says, I've done away with it. It's useless. I've gone back to using paper.
So where was there to go after Bernard Manning? Amazingly, the answer wasn't up. Because the mid-70s was a time when sleaze and nihilism were at the heart of mainstream cinema. This was the era of sexploitation. And the British B-movie was never more gleefully grubby and salacious than the one that you're about to see.
Every motorist has the opportunity to pick up a hitchhiker. For a lorry driver or commercial traveller, it could cost him his job. At times, you may wish the wife and kids were out of the way as you pass that miniskirt thumbing a lift. The producers of this film wish to give you the opportunity to judge for yourselves whether hitchhiking should be banned.
Take an Easy Ride purports to be a public information film of the Charlie Says variety, warning of the dangers of hitchhiking. But it also offers jollies to anyone in the audience who gets off on the idea of sexual assaults on hitchhikers. The film is punctuated with vox-popped opinions from people with interesting teeth and hair.
There has been fairly recent reports of young girls being raped and vice versa, you know.
Vice versa? What does he mean, vice versa? For me, Take an Easy Ride is a snapshot of British sensibility in the mid-1970s. We might not like it now, but this is part of the way we were. These locations, the dubious earnestness of its message that hitchhiking can sometimes be nice and sometimes a great social menace. Some of these hitchers have a good time, but some of them don't.
When you are a girl, it's easy to get lifts, but I made a point of waiting for the right lift. At least I thought it was the right lift.
This Swedish woman ends up coerced into a threesome, while Anne and Mary accept a ride from a faceless man in sinister leatherette driving gloves.
Ever tried this with your boyfriends? Here, let your friend have a look at it as well. Don't you like it?
Not much.
What follows isn't very funny. Rape and murder. And suddenly, this rather daft film has become brutal and ferocious. And this is the man who made Take an Easy Ride. The redoubtable Kenneth F. Rowles. Not sure what the F stands for.
I mean, there are several quite horrific scenes, aren't there? There's a scene of a murder in a car, and there's a rape scene in it as well. What do you remember about filming those?
Well, the rape scene was added because of the request of a distributor who wanted to liven it up a little bit with a bit more sex. So that
was like a request from the, you know, to market this film, we want a rape scene in it.
A bit more, yes, a bit more lively.
Lively is one way to describe it, but Ken was only obeying market forces. Take an Easy Ride is a reminder that our past isn't always as pleasant a place as we'd like it to be. But that's one of the functions of the British B-picture. Because it was intended only for native consumption, it shows you the sort of things that British audiences really liked.
Extraordinary thing, I think, to think how much this country has actually, in so many ways, moved on tremendously. That something like the rape and just the whole tenor of that film actually represents, and yet it's there in an awful lot of things. There's a sort of, you know, rude British sex films of the period. It's taken for granted.
Take an Easy Ride and the films with which it was billed in Soho and elsewhere are the end game for British B-movies. The audience was shrinking, and those sleazy exploitation double bills were scaring away as many people as they were attracting. Some of the features of 1976 sound pretty gruesome. What sort of person wanted to be seen coming out of a venue showing Dreams of 13 and The Younger the Better? Nobody you'd want to share a bathroom with, that's for sure. And the Edie levy meant that films like this were being subsidised by the state, but not for long.
By the end of the 70s, the Edie levy money, the production fund, was beginning to dry up. And with the arrival of the Tory government in 1979, that quickly went, and Margaret Thatcher also abolished the quota. She probably saw the kind of films that were being made.
There is a story that one of the reasons why the ED levy was abolished was because a member of your cabinet, I've no idea who it was, found themselves wandering through Soho and realised that all of these sex films on the hoardings were being made with ED money.
No, that is a totally apocryphal story.
You can
bin that one. I can't think of any of my fellow cabinet members who have been brought strolling round Soho incognito.
The British B-movie as we'd known it, sitting routinely at the bottom of the bill, had enjoyed one last great hurrah. Nicholas Rowe's Don't Look Now was supported by this film.
Come. It is time to keep your appointment with the Wicker Man.
On its release, this great movie was panned. One critic said it was like a school play and told punters to spend their money on Herbie Goes Bananas. Just because of their position on the bill, British B-movies rarely had a chance with the critics, and they're still waiting for one.
I think whereas American B-movies have had their sort of critical reappraisal, so things like Cat People, I don't think that British B-movies have, up to this point, enjoyed the same kind of reappraisal.
The American studios pulled out of Britain, and our film industry found itself gasping. Commentators were predicting the death of cinema itself. In that atmosphere, the British B-movie was doomed. Audiences wanted high-gloss escapism. They wanted The Empire Strikes Back or Chariots of Fire, not grubby British reality. Hundreds of cinemas were bulldozed or turned into pubs. Multiplexes sprang up, and going to the pictures stopped being cheap. It started to become more of a special occasion, more of a treat.
The next event will be the Egg and Spoon Race. Will competitors please assemble at the starting post?
But all this doesn't mean that we should forget the B-film. If you want to know Britain, then you could do worse than spend time consuming their unpretentious pleasures and their insights into our history and our way of life.
I think a lot of people warm to that because you're seeing your society and the world that you live in reflected on the screen in a way that perhaps you don't in other, you know, posher films.
Even those people who made these unassuming pictures agree, while they might sometimes be awful, they're part of our cinematic heritage.
As a piece of film history, they should be with the BFI, because they are film history, where they're good, bad, whatever. They were a very important time in the history of British cinema.
Hugo, walk to the footlights and thank them.
This is Devil Doll, just one film from thousands that are part of our B-movie history, a history we're only just beginning to recover. We've only scratched the surface in this documentary. I would have loved to have shown much more of little Johnny Mills getting a good thrashing. Or something of Todd Slaughter, who enjoyed killing people as much as his audiences loved watching him do it. I would have loved to have shown you the evil plotters who turned Blackpool Tower into a deadly tuning fork to fry the brains of everyone in northwest England. Or the la-di-da hipsters of Beat Girl.
Daddy-o, I'm over and out.
Play it down, doll.
Well, you've got to live for the kicks. That's all you've got.
Live.
There's little that's as eccentric or beguiling as this in films that had bigger budgets to spend. Our B-movies gave us images as diverse as Gert and Daisy in their underwear and giant simian horrors in Croydon. But they all had one thing in common.
The B-movie always gave value for money. Sure, some of them were rubbish, but they were never flatulent or self-regarding. The best of them offer as many good gags or moments of excitement as the films that they supported. And the worst? Well, even they can give you a shivery insight into the history of our collective imagination.
We all know how you like your women, Sydney, dear. Horizontal in 2 minutes flat.
And that's why I think they're important, why we should treasure them, why our sense of a shared cultural past is the poorer without some acknowledgement of the pleasure our parents and grandparents had with them in the dark, and why our present might still be enriched by the cheap thrills that they offer.
So here are their stars, a legion of comics and heroines and heroes and lovers. Most of them are dead now, but their work survives, ready to return to life at the push of a button, ready to remind us of the time when the Flickers offered a home from home, when a night at the pictures was a good deal, but no big deal, when pleasure was routine and everyone could afford it.
More film history next Monday here on BBC 4 with How the West Was Lost. Next tonight, though, curl up with a glass of something special for a BBC prom on 4.